Matthew Broderick races to save New York City from Godzilla. Robert Redford helps a troubled family as the Horse Whisperer. And Warren Beatty stars as a controversial senator named Bulworth. A very large lizard causes a great deal of inconvenience while trying to lay some eggs in Madison Square Garden in Godzilla, one of four new movies we're going to be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert, and we'll also have a report from the Cannes Film Festival. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times, and my colleague Gene Siskel had surgery a couple of weeks ago, and I'm very happy to report he's well on the road to recovery. Gene has seen all of the movies on today's program, and I think we're going to be hearing from him all during the show. Are you there, Gene?
Yes, I am, Roger. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune, and I hope that our producers have selected a really good photo of me that our audience will be forced to stare at for the next few minutes. Okay. I wonder if that such a photo exists.
You're looking great, Gene.
Oh, thanks.
You look fabulous. Okay.
You're an excellent critic.
Okay, now on to Godzilla, which plays like they took apart six other monster movies, threw out the good parts, and then tried to reassemble what was left in the dark. Anyone who has seen many giant creature movies will recognize all the obligatory stops along the way, like the ominous early warnings, the destruction of famous landmarks, and the monster who makes a comeback after you think it's dead. The monster is never dead the first time around in these movies. I didn't even mind the formula. I just wish it had been done better. Consider this scene, for example. Matthew Broderick plays a scientist called in to determine what kind of beast caused a disaster in Panama. Watch the way the movie goes for a cheap shot as the camera pulls back.
I'm a biologist. I take radioactive samples and I study them.
That's great. Here's your sample. Study it.
What sample?
You're standing in it.
I don't see it.
Yeah, it's a giant footprint, all right, but obviously the scientist would have known that he was in Panama to study footprints. Anyway, before long, Godzilla has arrived not at its usual destination of Tokyo, but in King Kong's old stomping grounds, New York. Another problem I had was with the monster's size. He's as tall as a 30-story building in some shots, and yet here they're afraid he might escape into the 20-foot-high tunnel system. Of course, logical questions like that are sort of beside the point. If Godzilla worked as a monster movie, I'd be happy, but it doesn't. There's not a single scary shot in the whole movie, and the monster itself lacks the majesty and mystery of the earlier movie Godzillas, even though they were in schlock films. Somebody told me it seemed less like a threat than like a pathetic, frightened animal, and you know, that's right.
Roger, I agree with you. You mentioned and complained that the film had all the standard elements of big monster movies.
Mm-hmm.
It's missing one, terror.
Exactly.
I was never afraid of Godzilla.
That's absolutely right, Gene. In fact, most of the time, I thought I'm just looking at special effects. I never had the illusion that there was a monster there at all. I just thought this is animation or this is some kind of a model.
You just see a big wrinkly creature, you know, stumbling across the landscape. There's no terror in this film, and that's stunning. I mean, that would be the last thing I would expect from this picture. Let me tell you another problem they have. Frequently, they use dialogue instead of action.
Mm-hmm.
For example, we're told that the monster, once he starts ripping through Manhattan, there's a report that there's looting in the Disney and Warner Brothers stores on 57th Street.
Yeah.
Show us that stuff.
Absolutely.
Don't have somebody say that in dialogue. Show it. It's obvious. It's a natural opportunity for humor with Godzilla playing with all the plush toys. It's not done.
What did you think about Mayor Ebert and his sidekick, Gene?
I thought that seemed petty.
Yeah, I did too.
It does seem petty, Roger. I mean, I was used as a villain in another picture called The Ref, and Siskel was the name of the villain. And, you know, it's such a distinctive name, an odd name, that, you know, audiences are thinking, well, all right, when's Ebert going to show up? Now, you shouldn't be thinking about that during a picture.
Yeah, the only good thing about Mayor Ebert and his sidekick was that at least Godzilla didn't step on us.
Well, but Roger, I fully expected that to happen. And I think the audience is waiting for that to happen.
Yeah, maybe they should have included that.
Again, they're...
Bring him on stage, at least squish him, right?
Exactly. There are missing scenes.
Okay, next movie. And our next film is Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, based on the classic work of gonzo journalism by Hunter S. Thompson. Now, I love Thompson's book, which came out in about 1972 and helped establish his reputation as one of the weirdest and most talented writers of his generation. It was a mixture of fact, fiction, and hallucination about how the writer and his attorney, both out of their minds on drugs, went to Las Vegas to cover a motorcycle race and a lawman's convention. Now comes the movie based on the book and starring Johnny Depp as the journalistic hero and Benicio del Toro as his sidekick. Depp is a fine actor, but here he delivers a performance all on one note, and all the dialogue has to work its way past the cigarette holder that's clamped in his mouth in every single scene.
You want me to go to Las Vegas at once? Make contact with a Portuguese photographer from the Serta. He'll have all the details. All I have to do, check out my soundproof suite. He'll seek me out. What do you think?
What I do like is the look of the movie. Director Terry Gilliam and his collaborators have done a convincing job of showing us Las Vegas as it might appear from inside a badly fried brain.
I desperately needed peace, rest, sanctuary. I hadn't counted on this. Finding my attorney on acid and locked into some kind of preternatural courtship.
After watching Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, I was trying to figure out why I liked the book so much and the movie so little, and I think maybe it's because the book was about the trip to Vegas, while the movie tries to be the trip to Vegas. It's always a lot more fun to listen to a drunk tell you about the crazy things he did last night than to watch the drunk while he's doing them. Gene?
I like the film, Roger. I think that the other reason why you like the book more is because Thompson is such a colorful writer. And we hadn't read this sort of material before. One of the things that the film does is communicate this empowerment of journalists. As journalists, I bet you had the same reaction. It was kind of exciting to hear about a guy who had an unlimited expense account and could do any, you know, and a phone card and could do anything he wanted to do.
Well, I didn't really find that very thrilling, because basically what I found was that he hardly knew what he was doing most of the time. I also felt that this cigarette holder and the dialogue, it was all on one note. There was no arc in the movie. It was kind of like just a loop that went around and around and around.
Well, there's no question. He's stoned out of his mind the whole time, so there's no real arc except when he comes down from the trip, I suppose. So it's a waiting game in that way. But, you know, what the film is about and what the book was about is also using Las Vegas as a metaphor or a location for the, you know, the worst of America, the extremes of America, the money obsession, the visual vulgarity of America.
Yeah, well, I think a movie like Scorsese.
There's a neat moment where a carpet design is transformed. And that's what I think the film is really about.
I thought Scorsese's Casino did a better job on Vegas because this... Anyway, I did like the visual look, so I agree with you about the carpet. Later in this program, Robert Redford is the horse whisperer. And coming up next, Warren Beatty plays a senator who says exactly what he thinks in Bulworth.
Isn't that obvious?
The ultimate Derek Jeter dream date. First you call a girl. Tell her that you're preparing a perfect candlelight dinner for her. I throw in some R&B. I can't cook, so I'm gonna order some food. Tell them to give me the works
and put it on my Discover card.
Splash on a little cologne. Throw on your apron. The Discover card cash back bonus. It's the icing on the cake. What else would she want to do but to watch highlights of us winning the World Series in 1996?
It pays to discover. To apply, call 1-800-IT-PAYS-2. Accepted where you see the Novus sign.
Are rich people taller than the rest of us? Are their loved ones more deserving of an airbag? Was the sun created solely for their enjoyment? Are we the only car company that doesn't think so? Century by Buick. Full of amenities for under 20,000. Loaded for under 24. Century by Buick. A luxury car for everyone.
I can see things clearly through this lens.
Smile.
And seeing their healthy white teeth made me realize mine weren't as white as I'd like. but I don't want a bleaching toothpaste. Lucky for me, something new just developed.
New Crest Extra Whitening with an enamel-safe polishing ingredient.
Kind of like a dentist paste. It doesn't bleach. Gently helps my natural whiteness shine through. Why did I become a Crest kid? Want 1,000 words or a picture?
New Crest Extra Whitening. Behind that healthy smile, there's a Crest kid.
Second half of the money.
If I'm not dead by Monday morning, I'm going to stop payment on that check.
Warren Beatty plays a disenchanted and depressed United States Senator from California in that scene who buys a murder contract on his own life in Bulworth, a political satire that Beatty also directed, co-wrote, and co-produced. And during that weekend that follows, as Senator Bulworth undergoes a fundamental change in his beliefs and personality, that shadow of death always hangs over him. It's like a murder contract sets him free to say what he really thinks instead of just mouthing political cliches.
I mean, come on, you can have a billion man march if you don't put down that malt liquor and chicken wings and get behind somebody other than a running back who stabs his wife. You're never going to get rid of somebody like me.
Well, his campaign strategist pulls the plug on that speech, but then the senator drives across town to a room full of rich men, heavy hitters in the entertainment industry, and tells them exactly what he thinks, too.
My guys are not stupid. They always put the big Jews on my schedule. You're mostly Jews here, right? What, 3 out of 4 anyway?
Excuse me?
Look, I'm sure Murphy put something bad about Farrakhan in here for you.
After his campaign stops, Bulworth is led by a young black woman named Nina and played by Halle Berry through a tour of South Central L.A., and she lets him know exactly what she thinks.
Senator, an optimistic, energized population throws up optimistic, energized leaders. And when you shift manufacturing to the Sun Belt and the Third World, you destroy the blue-collar core of the black activist population.
The media is electrified by a politician who speaks bluntly instead of playing it safe.
Come on. We got three pretty rich guys here getting paid by some really rich guys to ask a couple of other rich guys questions about their campaign. But our campaigns are financed by the same guys that pay you guys your money. So, I mean,
everybody knows that most of the shocking things the senator says are either really true or they have a basis in fact. It's just that no one ever says them out loud. The movie is especially merciless about the way both political parties allow legislation to be influenced by major campaign donors. There are lines in this movie that send a jolt through the audience, and I'm wondering, will there ever be a real political candidate like the character Beatty plays here? I doubt it. I don't think they'd let him on TV. Gene?
Roger, I like this film too, and its aggressive spirit attacking the political process. Warren Beatty has established his political credentials as a filmmaker long before this movie. Back in 1975, he made Shampoo. And what unites this film with that one, another superb film, is that he mourns the failure of the Democratic Party to deliver on its promise. And this is a theme throughout this picture, that the Democrats simply haven't delivered. And that the people who could use the underclass, that could use their help, has nowhere else to turn that's going to, frankly, be of help.
That's very much set up in an early shot in his office that shows a montage of photographs of political heroes from the 60s, Robert Kennedy, Martin Luther King, and so forth, and we feel that that whole legacy has somehow been sidetracked or misapplied. And what I like is the fact that Beatty is really making a high-risk movie here. This is a high-wire act. This movie could go terribly, terribly wrong, and I give him a lot of points just for taking a chance and going ahead with it and going all the way with it, with all the stops out.
Well, let me tell you, a lot of people have seen the TV ads for this film where he spouts off, you know, incendiary, offensive remarks. And you could think, you could imagine, just on the basis of the TV ads, that this is, you know, something like a stand-up act on the Comedy Channel, mm-hmm. where, you know, you insult everybody to get attention. This film is better than that. In fact, the picture that it reminds me of, that film is Paddy Chayefsky's Network. Because as Howard Beale railed in that film against television, Beatty is really railing against American politics.
That's right. That's exactly what you have here, is a man who was fed up, who was exploding with anger, and on the screen and in the audience,
He's mad as hell, too, and he isn't going to take it anymore.
Okay, when we come back, Robert Redford is the horse whisperer.
Well, truth is, I help horses with people problems.
See, Grace, I got a problem. When I work with a horse, I like to know its history.
To heal a teenage girl and her horse, Robert Redford needs to know exactly how their accident took place in that early scene from The Horse Whisperer. Redford directed and co-produced the movie and stars as a wise and patient man whose gifts are needed not only to heal a wounded horse, but also to heal the teenage girl whose leg has been amputated after a riding accident.
You want to eat something else, honey? We can order out something else.
No, I'm just not that hungry, that's all.
Well, you should try to eat anyway. Anyway, you're going to get
this. I said I wasn't hungry.
That's Scarlett Johansson as young Grace and Kristen Scott Thomas and Sam Neill as her parents. The mother, a high-powered New York Magazine editor, reads about a legendary horse whisperer famous for his gentle ways with horses and people who lives in Montana, and she thinks she can just order him up over the phone.
Look, I'm really sorry for your situation, but there's nothing I can do.
You just called the wrong person is all. I'm sure there's some fine horse doctors back east.
No, but I don't want a horse doctor.
Determined to have her way, the mother drives the horse and her daughter out west to find Redford, who cautions them that there are no quick results.
Now, here's the deal. I don't know that I can do anything, but I'm prepared to give it a go if you'll help.
The best scenes in the movie involve the rapport between the cowboy and the young girl. And then love begins to grow also between the whisperer and the editor from New York.
Can I do anything?
Just make yourself comfortable.
I am comfortable.
The storyline of The Horse Whisperer, based on the novel by Nicholas Evans, is basically a soap opera, but Redford has toned down the novel, left out some of the more sensational aspects, and brought out, I think, the underlying values. His visual sense of the West is so majestic it almost becomes another character in the movie, which is beautiful to look at, and I admire the relationship between the older man and the vulnerable girl. It's not a perfect movie. It felt too long, I thought, and I didn't sense any real chemistry between Redford and Kristen Scott Thomas, but on the whole, it's a really fine film. Gene?
Well, that's where we differ, Roger, because I thought that the guts of the movie, the heart of the movie, was between Redford and Kristen Scott mm-hmm. Thomas in this sense. It's almost, you could view this picture almost as a companion piece to The Bridges of Madison County. In both films, you have a profoundly lonely wife. And Redford comes in, a stranger from the West, as Eastwood does in Madison County, to provide companionship, to listen, to be present with her.
But that's the difference, I think, between the two movies, is that in Madison County, I felt there was a real, real chemistry between Clint Eastwood and Meryl Streep. And in this movie, I never felt it. I felt as if the characters were going through the paces of this relationship, but that the real feeling, the real emotion was between the cowboy and the young girl.
That's an interesting response, but it's not mine. And the other strong element, as you mentioned in this film, is the visual element. Redford, literally a mm-hmm. man of the West, mm-hmm. empowers. I think what he really thinks, and I get through this film, is that the landscape can be healing.
Probably that is an element there, because there was a lot of landscape in the movie, but in this film it's more like an idealized sort of West that plays a role in the spiritual lives of these characters.
Well, let's put it this way. If we're noticing the landscape and Robert Redford is standing in front of it, that tells you how good looking the landscape is.
Okay. Coming up next, a report from the Cannes Film Festival, the biggest film event in the world.
It is so unfair the way guys can just eat and eat, eat, and then, oh, let's eat some more.
Life just got a little more fair.
It's like there's no time. Why am I not eating? Unfair.
Introducing Sweet Crispers, chocolatey wafers that are so sweet and crispy, you won't want to stop eating them. And with 18 in a serving, you won't have to.
They're like bottomless pits.
Sweet Crispers, life just got a little more fair.
Oh, I wish I were a guy. No, I don't.
Friends, 10-3-2-1 has changed to 10-10-3-2-1, but nothing's really changed. You still save over AT&T on every call in the U.S. and still save 50% on every call over 20 minutes. There's no need to sign up. Just dial 10-10-3-2-1, then 1, then the number as usual.
For me,
it's the 50%, isn't it?
I've just returned from the French Riviera, where the 51st annual Cannes Film Festival ended after 12 days of nonstop screenings in what felt like a worldwide convention of celebrities. Here we see Gong Li, Andy McDowell, Emmanuel Bayard, Tim Roth, Robert Duvall, and Godzilla star Jean Reno arriving for the festival's closing night. Chairman of the jury this year was American director Martin Scorsese, who said he was looking for a film that would change his life. At the closing night award ceremonies, the show was stolen by Roberto Benigni, an Italian comic actor who was so delighted to win the jury prize that he turned his acceptance speech into a scene from a screwball comedy. His winning film, named Life is Beautiful, raised controversy among some journalists at the festival who accused it of making light of the Holocaust. I disagree. I think it sees nothing funny about the Holocaust, but it's about a man who uses humor, which is the only weapon he has, to fight back and try to protect his son. Next up to the podium to accept the Palme d'Or, or first prize, was the Greek director Theo Angelopoulos for his film Eternity and a Day. In addition to the jury prizes, there are critics' prizes at Cannes, and the critics' award to the best single film in the whole festival was voted to Happiness by Todd Solondz, whose Welcome to the Dow House was a success on the independent circuit a couple of years ago. When we come back, the video pick of the week, a new Batman film in animation.
First came the Magic Kingdom, then Epcot, then Disney MGM Studios, and now... Introducing the most adventurous Walt Disney World theme park ever. Disney's Animal Kingdom. The imagination of Disney. Gone wild.
Siskel and Ebert's video pick of the week is brought to you by Nestle Raisinets. At the movies or at home, Raisinets.
My pick this week is a recent animated film named Batman and Mr. Freeze, Sub-Zero. This is a made-for-video spin-off of the television series, and yet it has a pacing and energy that make it compare very well with the top-heavy live-action Batman films, especially Batman and Robin. The plot involves Mr. Freeze, the man whose health requires him to live in a refrigerated lifestyle, but this time he doesn't want to conquer the world, he only wants to save his beloved wife. She has an illness that has no cure, and he's keeping her cryogenically frozen until medical science finds a way to revive her.
Fragile beauty clinging to life in this frozen wasteland.
But then her capsule is broken open and he desperately needs an organ transplant to preserve her. A transplant that can come from only one person, Barbara Gordon of Gotham City, also known as Batgirl.
Get away from her.
You get away from me.
The freedom of animation allows the film to create Batman's film noir universe with a lot of style and atmosphere. And for once, Robin comes across as a fully realized character, not simply an awkward sidekick.
Stand back!
The movie is now in video stores. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two thumbs down for Godzilla, the overwrought and underachieving monster movie. We split, though, on Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. I felt it didn't find a way to put any ironic distance between itself and its subject, but Gene thought it was a great commentary on American values as reflected in Las Vegas. Two thumbs way up for Warren Beatty's high-risk political satire, Bulworth, with its liberating anarchy. And two more thumbs up for Robert Redford's The Horse Whisperer, a sensitive story beautifully told. So the two we both agree on are The Horse Whisperer and Bulworth.
Yes, and Bulworth is the one that I strongly recommend. It is brave, aggressive filmmaking.
Okay, that's it for this week. We hope Gene will be back in the balcony very soon. Remember, you can hear our reviews on the web at siskel-ebert.com. And next week, we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including The Truman Show, starring Jim Carrey as a man who lives his life in public, and A Perfect Murder, starring Michael Douglas and Gwyneth Paltrow in a thriller about deadly double crosses. That's
Roger,
next.
I have just one question. Mm-hmm. Has anybody tried to sit in my seat?
Nobody.
Good. Keep them out.
Okay. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
Blast your taste buds with the butterlicious taste of Blast-O-Butter, the ultimate movie theater microwave popcorn. New from Jolly Time Popcorn. Reduced fat Skippy peanut butter, same great peanut taste, and now even easier to spread. Reduced fat Skippy.
Know what's inside Lean Pockets ham and cheddar? Lean smoked ham, real cheddar cheese, and still only 7 grams of fat.
What are you gonna pick?
Lean Pockets.
Carnation Instant Breakfast, packed with 21 essential vitamins and minerals. It's a healthy start to your day. Carnation Instant Breakfast from Nestle.